3.5, identify some of the continuing improvements that have been made to be delivered the service. You'll know this is a fairly regular feature and I constantly look to sort of evaluate and appraise how we go about delivering the service. I'll see monitoring and benchmarking against the providers. Members are asked to note that all take any appropriate actions, but I'm more than happy to take any questions if I have it later, so we can get some to do.
People okay with that? The only thing I would say is that the report is still a bit sort of, you know, three items and all that sort of stuff. It doesn't quite pick up what the three items were. I know we do a lot of audits for schools, unless there was something, you know, shocking that came out of that. I don't think we need to see all of those, we should cut it down a bit.
Happy to do whatever the members wish.
Does that seem sensible? I'd like to know what we're actually finding, really, children.
Okay,
super, thank you very much. Item 7 then, corporate risk register. Who's making up that one for us?
I'm presenting this on behalf of Cllr, who is with us this evening. Purpose of the report is to provide members with an update on the progress being made to ensure the council has effective arrangements in place to manage risk. A copy of the updated corporate risk register provided to yourselves for comments and attachments. The report identifies some minor changes to the scoring of two risks included on the register at section 3.5 on page 346. Explains how the council with increased mitigation the likelihood of this materialising in the review of senior officers has reduced slightly, so the risk is and is scored in reduced amount. Section 3.6 to 3.8 are pages 347. Additional risks to the organisation have been identified for potential inclusion on the register. These involve information management and the climate emergency. Work is currently being undertaken by us to evaluate the exact nature of these risks and to allow for more informed discussion regarding whether they should or shouldn't be included in the register. This will be shared with yourselves via the risk workshop, which members should have been led to and contacted in relation to the time and place. I think it's scheduled for earlier in COVID. This again is something that the Chair was keen to reinstate. Section 3.9 to 14 from page 347, detailed actions currently undertaken by officers to strengthen corporate risk management arrangements and include the appointment of the risk and continuity manager with effect from the 1st of October, which I alluded to earlier. Members should note that following discussion with the Chair, the next risk deep dive is scheduled for November 19, where the Director of Analytical Care and Health would be invited along to attend the meeting and answer questions from yourself in relation to. Members are requested to note the report again, and I'm happy to try and address any questions that you can
have. The agenda for November is looking pretty long, so we can avoid any long meetings. That's probably good. I'm reading this out of the paper, so I have no idea what the colours are for most of it. It all looks broad and grey. As I'm looking at it. Look at that. So, the thing that gets me with risk registers is we give something a rating as red, which I'm presuming is bad in these terms. Then we take a load of actions, and it's still red. So, how useful will the actions if we're still, it's still rated that badly? We either haven't taken sufficient action, or the action we're taking is the wrong stuff. But the idea of the workshop is it's going to be a relatively manageable group, isn't it? So we can actually get into the guts of this process from all the representative. So we'll are people more content to know this at the moment and agree the extra work we're going to do?
Yeah.
Is that agreed? Yeah, okay, good. Next then. I think again,
this is me through your chair here. This is the purpose of the report is to advise members of the continued utilisation by my service, the Internal Service, of a what's called the Comprehensive Quality Assurance Improvement Programme. It's been developed very specifically to comply with the requirements of the accepted Internal Standards and is attached to the report of the Bank. the actual equipment which referred to incorporates within it various methods utilised by myself and the team to evaluate and ensure that continued service quality. It includes various performance measures, client feedback questionnaires, post audit assessments, and the use of key policies across my team. Members' attention is also drawn to section 6 of the report on page 359. To where the annual self-assessment against the equipment undertaken by myself, and I'm pleased to report that I'm very content with
the game. So
I will look at it, but trust me, the evidence is clearly there, and I hope you can see that from the magic that we take to the
board. I mean, I just thought good stuff, and we've done it for a while, and I think we've got a really good internal audit service. I think it's certainly well led. I'm sure the whole committee would agree to that. I think my question is, this is, you know, the quip is from a single point, one presumes, and it does all local authorities and all that. Okay. Do we actually go out and speak to other audit services within the public sector, for instance? Because I know how we do it, we follow this programme pretty closely. But I just wonder, rather, I think of the government audit service. I had some experience of when I was working. I'm sure Robin sees a range of different internal audit services and how they're organised, and the profile, what they do, what they don't do, and so on and so forth. And I just wonder, do you have the opportunity? And if you do, that's great. If you don't, I think you should have the opportunity to look at how, if there is anything that we can supplement this particular service with good stuff that goes on elsewhere or more broadly around and about the place.
Thank you, Jay. I'd be pleased to hear that you spent a significant amount of time looking at what others do and how they do it. I'm a member of various groups across the country, London. I'm a member of the North West Chief Internal Officers Working Group, I know, which looks at a range of bodies, for public and private sector, comparing and contrasting how we deliver and what. I'm not averse to making from the best. I'll have to play device.
Yeah, good.
Within reasons, I think so. It is something we do. I'll continue to do.
Right. Okay. Any other questions around the marks improvement programme? No? Okay. How do you improve on perfectionists? Really? Went down the downside. Okay. All right. Thanks for that. Next item is procurement use of contract procedure rules. Who's going to take us through that?
Chair.
Sorry. Okay. Sorry, Keith. You were sitting in Mike Sullivan's place for the last
time.
Yeah. Okay. Keith.
Yes.
You're our head of commercial procurement, are you not?
I am, sir, yes.
Good man. Well placed to tell us why I'm spending £100,000 on as well,
please. I'll start with this.
Okay.
So this report is informs the committee of the range and number of contracts awarded, which have been subject to contract procedure rules. And also contract procedure rule 12, waiving the rules, and rule 13, extensions and variations.
So, can I just check if I got this right? So, RAD 2 and 3 are people that aren't going through the proper procedure in terms of tendering, or if contracts are coming to an end and just doing an extension. 4, RAD 4 would be if a new contract has been let, but with our procurement rules or outside of the three tenders part?
There or thereabouts. So Prad 1 is a request for exception.
Right.
Prad 2 is a request for extension. Prad 3 is a request for a variation. And Prad 4 is a standard contract award.
Yeah. So if we see Prad 1, 2 and 3, that would suggest we are not getting all the relevant tenders, we just kind of
funding needs to review that would mean that we'd have to put a temporary arrangement in place.
Which is the example you gave, Chair, somebody has simply forgotten the contract has run out and had to do things very urgently, and we've had to fill the gap.
Or we don't have a system in place,
yes.
Or we haven't engaged with the procurement team early enough for them to guide you to where you need to be to get the best value for that particular service. Is that right?
Yes, that's possible.
Yeah, okay.
Okay. So would you like to carry on, sir?
Yes, please.
So in terms of the numbers that go with the period that we've submitted on this occasion, which takes us from the 1st of October 2018 to the 31st of March 2019.
That's quite a long time, okay.
Yeah, I note the Chair's concerns. I would just point out that I've only been in position since the 1st of April, and I'm following the protocol of my predecessor. I'll be happy next time to produce the report based on those previous 6 months.
Well, if you could, because my experience suggests, and I'm sure colleagues will agree, there's a lot of money to be saved by doing procurement properly and following the procurement rules. And going back to this compliance culture, you know, we talk about health and safety and about a range of others, if we're actually following our procurement processes, we're confident that they're right and properly, there is the potential to save money in terms of some of these procurements we make. You know, and that we can either use it to have more services or we can use it to reduce. But procurement must be a huge area where we can save money if we do it properly. And we get the departments to engage with procurement instead of thinking there's a whole pile of rules they can do without. And they're just like the lab who's been doing it for the last 5 years to carry on doing it because they've got good relationships.
Completely agree, Chair.
So, I suppose the question my question is how then, so I'd like that report, but how do we drive compliance with those? Do we check our procurement rules fit for purpose? And how do we drive compliance against those rules? That's a cabbage. How can you provide us with assurance that we are driving those behaviours, those compliance behaviours with our procurement?
Okay, so my response is that you'll notice in this report that it actually has to appear that we have report that put some improvement measures in place,
right.
Which we are currently in the process of following. So if you'd like to go through the improvement measures.
Sure.
So we've engaged with the senior leadership team to implement a programme of new measures on behalf of backing of the Chief Executive and Section 151 Officer. We're embarking on a contract review planning to engage with commissioners early in respect of contract renewals, with particular focus on exception requests and contract extensions. We are going to conduct a new programme of contract procedural training during November and December. We have developed a no-PO, no-pay workstream to improve the efficiency and effectiveness of the procurement pay process.
I'm surprised you have to write that down. Is this something CAF and I know other people have been pushing for? Since you've been on this, how come there are still things being paid that there's no a PO for?
We are looking into that as we speak. So we're conducting a programme of review.
Constitutional, well, so, and the operators don't blame them, trust me, but we are all accountable and we all have responsibility to learn. Kath, given what we've
the NOPA and OPA programme has been in place officially since the 1st of April, so there was a, I think a report came to SLT in November last year, which proposed the NOPA and OPA programme. So since the implementation, since the 1st of April, we've done a review of what that looks like. There are still areas of improvement required, and that's in part why we've decided to put an improvement plan in place, Chair.
So I think the I think what we're asking is, as well as the update on the prads, the other thing on that report would be useful to what the reason was given via prad once, because it does list the reason why someone wanted to have a prad once, so it could be good to have that. But I think we'd also welcome some information around how many POs are still being, how many payments are still being made without POs, and why? I think that's probably it, Catherine. Does that seem sensible? Yeah. Okay. Audit, this is easy savings. This is easy money. Do you know what I mean? It should be easy savings for the council to achieve without any impact to service or to staff or whatever. It should just be really straightforward. Okay, sorry, keep going.
So just to what you need to do.
Yeah, of course. And apologies for being too loquacious. deal with it, deal with it voluntary, or, you know, monitors that was the most successful way to procure that amount of service based on the outcomes that we want. You know what I mean? It's all very well. I've always had a real distrust of single tender action. I can understand it when it's a bridge builder, it's the only bridge builder that was in like four bridges and so on. But some of these services just look like stuff the council does every day. And that's, what is it? Can you add up how much the grant was come to? Did you add that down?
I have got to say the chair, sorry,
yeah. It looks like a number of millions to me. Even if you just say general centre. Sorry, Kate.
Sorry, I was just going back to just point out that I think certainly in children's services, which are children's accounts, that's something that we are looking into at the moment, we're outcome based. I think that we constantly be tendered every single year and we be procuring the same services, but actually we don't have outcome data for that. So that is something that we're looking into at the moment about the multiple services.
It would be nice to get some assurance. That's about some dark head of procurement, be the right person to start with what we do. That's the outcome that we are contracting and procuring in a way that is going to deliver best value for money. And that there is work that goes on to evaluate some of these contracts before we move into a re-procurement. I'm imagining a big spreadsheet somewhere. With all our contracts and when they become due, and a period in front of that when all the activity about testing the market, making sure you get the best advice and so on, before you move to the procurement stage, has actually taken place. And I'm guessing you pull that massive spreadsheet.
Yes, there's a contract register that holds all that information.
And so you are confident, you can give us some assurance that those departments are engaging with you in sufficient time to do these re-procurements.
I can give you assurance that we are notified, we are in the hands of commissioners to renew contracts clearly because the services belong to the commissioners. And I will give you assurance that we are working with commissioners as we speak to improve the way in which information is coordinated between ourselves and the commissioner.
Well, we're going to get a further report, aren't we? But at the moment, I'm not going to.
I just looking at the civil world and weight watch. I've got people like civil world and weight watch in my head, all with the amount. And you might have been on a scale to just extortionate the ground. But people pay for them, so why are you giving people money?
I think that's a slightly, it's a good question, but a slightly tangential question. Because that's a, because I understand that public health side of you, and you need to go into to speak to public health about what outcome they were expecting, whether they delivered it, which as a councillor any of us has the right to. My thing is, it might not be if you want to do something about health with weight loss and a range of other good stuff, covered by companion, but you would expect that to be procured
which part of that will be and how that will be spent. So just see how you need a lot of data coming out to you as well in order to improve it.
I mean, I think you did well, Gillian. And I think what we're trying to suggest here, if you pick it up, and I'm hoping to go back to the chief exec or whoever, that we want to support you in getting that that discipline and that compliance around these sorts of things. Because, as I keep saying, this is easy money to save if we can get the right, the same level of service properly specified and get the right outcomes, and we can get it for less money through smart contracting. And that has to be the way. I thought we had, didn't we set up in a previous existence, a procurement org or a commissioning org? Does the council have a hope that's going to do all the commissioning? I'll just wait for an answer.
We have a commissioning officers group that meets on a regular basis.
We call that a hub.
It's not, well, we could call it a hub if it's not
a hub.
It is a hub.
Yeah. Go on, Phil. Go on, tell me. Tell me.
I think the commissioning hub was a term of art in the management structure. It's a important topic. We're now in a world of changing that.
So we did have one that just didn't do it. But it was broken.
And it was commissioning in a different sense, not procurement as such, but commissioning in the commissioner provider. You know, I say fuzzy in the US, that kind of term of art.
Yes, you might. Catherine.
Bearing in mind this is all taxpayer money.
Yes.
There's something here which I thought might have been, well, it's to supply goods and services for the user to hand on by the way.
I'm guessing that's it's not the cambio drills, isn't it?
Yes,
I'm
guessing. Well, that's a good quantifiable thing, isn't it? Because you can just make sure that people don't get injured at work, go off sick to cost money. So that's worthwhile. But I still can't get my head around the labour management. I have 200,000 to Weight Watchers and still work. How do you quantify whether that's work?
It should be relatively straightforward. Sorry, call.
Yeah, just be sort of thing, I'd be away from the daily level, yeah. To actually see them in front of 200 grand of Weight Watchers and still under the other thing, yeah, they really need to see that's a lot of council spending 200 grand of Weight Watchers. But there's got to be reason and projects behind that and services, etc. And how we would as a committee sit through every one of them, see the value for money by saying it's that proper contract.
Hello.
But we've got to avoid sort of jump back and things. Please.
Oh, God bless you, come. Carl, get always go just in case I'm going to defend. I think the issue for us is, and this is the point, we want as a committee, it's somebody else's job, I'm quite clear about this, to determine what services are required, and they are accountable for making those decisions and so on and so forth. Our job, and this is the bit that's concerning me, is these are contracts that have not gone through what we'd expect normal council contracts to go through. These have been single tender actions. So that's either we haven't specified them correctly, we haven't procured them properly, and no one really knows what the outcomes have. So I think what we've asked for is that further report that will look at how we can, as a council, improve our procurement and how we can make sure we know why some of these have been single tender action, but how we can make sure our procurement is as compliant and as tight as possible, so as we can pick this up and make sure that we can assure ourselves that the cabinet and all the rest of are making proper decisions around procurement
quick observations, I think. So, I mean, I think that I've had the benefit of sitting in this committee for a number of years. I seem to recall that at one stage we had an actual annual governance statement improvement area around Europe, didn't we? And so I think that it's something that's been a focus in the past. I think there's been some progress. It was, you know, what I'm hearing, I think, it suggests that maybe there's perhaps a need to reinvigorate that would be one thing. I think it's difficult to form conclusions. It's difficult to form conclusions as to whether, you know, complying with the procedure rules and not going through the right process, does that necessarily represent bad money for money? I mean, it's a concern, I think it's right the committee should continue to focus on it. I was probably most concerned about those ones where people have been rejected when they apply retrospectively. That would be my biggest concern, to be honest with you. So I think it's something it's right to pick up and just refresh the whole focus on that.
Second curve. Okay, and with that then, can we come